So today we're going to begin, or we're going to present part 13 of our book review and commentary on No Solar. From last week, I gave a monologue, my own impressions, and Brent wasn't here. Today, Brent's back and will lead the presentation with his comments on the book and reflections on my comments last week. And then I want to add some more at the end after that. And we're, approaching the wrap up. We may not wrap it up fully today, but next time. And there are some also group questions that we can handle. But today I want to hear Brent's going to give his perspectives on the book and on my comments, and take us in some other directions to deepen understanding. So, Brent?
Thanks. I appreciate that, Scott. And thank you for covering everything last week while I had to be gone for the week. Yeah, I think personally, as far as my perspectives go, I think that one of the most important things to realize is for me, as reading the book, first I saw the movie and then I actually went and read the whole book, and it was even though it was a short read, I think it was a very important read because it seemed to put into actual daily practice everything that we've been studying about as wanderers over the years. I mean, we read from a lot of different authors, not only just the raw material, but also maybe the Seth material, in my case, several other books over the years as I was doing my search. And I spent a long time reading the Urantia book, for example, but then realized after several years that there were some missing things there that didn't quite fulfill my need anymore. And it obviously I realized it wasn't approved by Council of Saturn. But that's beside the point. The point is that you read these things, but you don't see or witness any examples of it all being put into practice. I mean, we try and be kind, we try and be good, we try and live good lives, we try and help people, we try and do positive things, especially with our families. You know, we try and help the needy, but and then we go to study groups and we talk to each other, and we if we can, in certain ways, we connect with other wanderers or other people of like mind. And but it's not quite the same. And here you have a daily example of people living in the astral city, doing what they can. And some of the very, very first examples too. Andre realized and was saved by Clarence and realized that he wasn't quote unquote just dead. Things did not just end for him. And came out of the lower zones. He even realized that something as simple as self-pity is something that needs to be cured, something we need to get away from. And we've all been through that. We've all gone, oh my God, you know, this life is hard. This is, you know, we go through possible, you know, light bouts of depression maybe. I know that I have in my life. And you think about, you know, Clarence in chapter 6 on page, let me see here, this is page 34, I don't know, 35, after when Andre is still going through his healing process, Clarence listens to Andre being very upset and concerned, and Clarence says, you know, my dear friend, you really seek a spiritual cure. Self-pity is a symptom of mental illness, which is time-consuming and difficult to cure. So, you know, and I read that and I thought, well, you know, there's been many times in my life that I felt self-pity. Poor me, I didn't get this, or I didn't do that, or I got rejected here, or that job didn't come through, or I got a low grade in my class, whatever it was, you know. And it's basically all self-pity, and we do it all the time. I mean, you know, we grow up doing it. I think right there is just a very minor example of Okay, a simple of maybe a very minor mental illness, but hey, we've all got it, so there we go. We all have our problems down here that we're having to deal with. So that's an example of something that we can begin to do to help cure ourselves. But then there's so many other examples living in the book. When he begins to go to work in the chambers of regeneration. And before I go to that, I am going to go to that, but I'll backtrack just a little bit and say that one of the most profound things that I learned too was once he realized that he was awake and alive in his astral body, if you actually read the book, I'm hoping that you came to the same realization as a reader, and that is that you realized that you were not. That you are more than just your physical body. Yes, we all think that. Yes, we all hope that. But you begin to get the perspective from his point of view that we are spiritual beings just having a physical experience to learn lessons. And that we have been around, many, 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 many years, hundreds of years, thousands of years, some longer than others. Some have had maybe just a few lives, some have had several hundred lives, some have had thousands of lives. And that we keep coming back and we keep learning lessons, and that it is actually a blessing. It's a blessing from the Father that He allows us to forget our past, misdeeds, our past sins, our past transgressions, and come back and start over fresh, wipe the slate clean. And try and learn something here and rectify the problem. Yes, we have to go through karma. Yes, we have to make amends for what we did. That's part of the deal. But you think, oh, we're behind the veil. Sometimes I've even said, if the real problem, we're behind the veil, and it's so limiting. And I don't understand why I'm trying to learn this, and why am I going through that, and why do I have to suffer with this particular thing? And it's all from something that we are either helping somebody else to, or we are helping ourselves overcome, from past mistakes, so that we can grow and learn. And the other thing too that I think was very profound was when he, just how strongly we are attached to our physical bodies. When he witnessed in chapter 33 on page 146, they were taking a break through in the chambers, reeling, and then he was, and then he witnessed healing, not reeling. He witnessed the two apparitions out in the garden, and I'm looking quickly here for their. Yeah, here we go. This is on page 147. A few minutes later, I saw two enormous shapes. They puzzled me and looked like men of some indefinable semi-luminous substance. Strange filaments hung from their arms and feet, and there was a thread connected to their heads. And they gave me the impression of two ghosts. And he was scared. His hair stood on end, and he ran back into the chambers to get Narcissa and, come out and tell him what was going on. She started laughing and explained that they were just still connected to their bodies, but they were astral traveling, basically. And it shows you, just from those filaments, that while they were allowed to travel briefly in the astral plane while they were sleeping or resting, that how bound we are to the physical body while we're here. And how that, of course, we learned how that affects the illnesses that people come back with. I think many are lucky to not come back from this existence without any illnesses that they need some sort of healing from. Andre himself, yes, he had the damage around his abdomen and intestinal area from from the surgery and from the ulcers and from everything from what he had done from his the illnesses he had from his life and things. Basically the abuse he put his body through. But so the physical ailments good examples are on page 119, when he goes in and let's see, there was a couple that really struck me. Just as a quick, we all read them earlier, but just as a reminder. Okay, with step pain compressors for the attack. Sorry, pause here for a minute.
Yeah, I can make a point while you're looking, if you like.
Okay, yeah, go.
Okay, piggybacking on your comment about Dr. Louise and self-pity.
Yes.
Very interesting material. And yeah, I think all of us have felt sorry for ourselves when we've faced, you know, various troubles and pains and losses. Page 35, the direct teaching from Clarence that you referenced, he said, learn not to speak so much of yourself and your sufferings. Number one. And a lot of people are so self-focused, self-centered, actually, that much of what they say is simply themselves and their sufferings. And I mean, I watch for this in talking with anybody. How quickly will it go when I say, I had a good day today? How quickly will they say, oh, I had a good day too, or I had a bad day, or you know what happened to me? How quickly will they bring the focus of conversation back to themselves? It's really, I mean, you might want to look for that, you know, folks in TV land. When you're talking to people, try to observe, if you wish, how quickly they bring it back to themselves. It's really very common. And the view here, he says, self-pity is a symptom of mental illness, which is time-consuming and difficult to cure. That I think, is an overstatement, frankly, because at a deeper level, self-pity is a distorted means of self-healing. Self-pity is a distorted form of self-love, is a distortion of love. It's basically kind of fermenting unhelpfully. I mean, I know fermented food is good, yes, but don't ferment your mind. Mental fermentations, called sanskara, is concoctions and excessive narrative. And self-pity takes genuine self-caring to an excessively fermented concoction called self-pity. Or it is an excessively fermented form of self-care, where the person got hurt or feels bad, and rightly ought to pay attention to that. But self-pity is a kind of distorted corruption of simple self-comforting, or seeking comfort and appreciation or support from other, whereby self-pity falls into some almost an idealization of myself and my pain, and devaluation of others and their process, and it's called getting stuck. Obviously, it's a very clear form of being stuck, or a manifestation of what stuck equals. And I don't think it is exactly a symptom of mental illness. But, I mean, I you know, some of the teaching here, I think, is, I think we can do better than some of the spiritual guidance here in certain cases, frankly. Because underneath self-pity is a need for love, is a longing to be loved by other, and demonstrates the need for greater self-love and self-care, where the person realizes that it's good to lick your wounds. It's good to take time for rest and recuperation, because yes, I've been hurt. Yes, you're in pain. I'm in pain. But my pain is not the most important matter in this world, and other people are in pain too. And simply calling everyone's attention to my pain isn't the way of healing it. It doesn't really heal. What's needed is the person to really acknowledge what happened and admit their loss and their pain, and comfort and console themselves, and then move on to better decisions or positive decisions that make their life better once again. And the guidance, some of the guidance here is, it's imperative that you create new trains of thought and control your words. Well, again, that seems heavy-handed to me. Controlling your words is restraining your speech. That's true. And that's the real heart of the teaching of right speech, which is wise restraint of one's mouth, so that one doesn't speak excessively, one doesn't speak frivolously, one doesn't speak harshly or maliciously. True, that's restraint. But in terms of create new trains of thought, that's also true in that one needs to understand what happened and, if possible, try not to avoid the same situations that gave rise to the pain as the basis of the self-pity. And then it says the only way to spiritual balance is to open your heart to divine light. That completely means nothing. What does it mean? Open your heart to divine light. Where's the divine light? In the sky? In the light bulb? Where is it? Everywhere. Okay, how do you do that? Well, you just. What? It's the same as Ra's teaching, the moment contains love. That's true. But a lot of this teaching is for people who are really, quite attached to materiality, as you said, Brent, and that's another point. But the final point, I know I'll go right back to you here, but the final point that Clarence made regarding self-pity is this on 35, I think 35, 36 said, the more you dwell on your painful, on your own painful experiences, the more you bind yourself to them. And that's the point. The more that we dwell on something, the bigger it gets. And if we dwell on the fact that we had pain, it becomes all-consuming. And that is one basis of self-pity. But just controlling your words or trying to think a different way is not quite, I think, a very helpful approach. I think a more psychological, this book has some, is moderately psychologically sensitive. And I would say that the solution is greater love. And another dynamic is that this book is very God-focused, Christ-centered, Catholic Christian. And there is a, they have real issues with self-love. So that's another point. So anyway, back to Brent, before I spin out into some other trains of thought.
No, thank you, Scott. I appreciate it. Absolutely right. I was going to mention that is a good and excellent point about the book. And I think because it was written, we have to keep always keep in mind it was written in 1930, and for a general populace who are very heavily Christian, very heavily Catholic Christian. And so you got to keep that. We always do have to keep that in the back of our mind as we're reading it. At least I did. And weed out. I had to weed out those passages that were very heavy-handed as far as Christianity was concerned, and those times, like you said, open your heart to the divine light. Well, you're right. What does that mean? I mean, okay, I'm standing here, I'm opening my heart. Where's the divine light? It's coming down from the sky. I mean, right. It's very basic, and I think it's a very it's almost like an elementary primer, like elementary school reading primers, it's a spiritual, it's a basic spiritual primer for Christian-oriented individuals, with some very touching on some excellent topics as they go along, just to kind of plant some seeds, I think, And you also touched on the thing I was going to go on to next, exactly, is they mention, of course, especially beginning in talking about self-pity, the importance of thought, the importance of, and I don't think, and I agree, it shouldn't necessarily be controlling one's thoughts, but being mindful maybe is a better way to put it. And there's examples all the way through. I go back to what chapter is this? Chapter 27, when he begins work in the chamber. There's several examples. The very first one he comes across, there's an example of abuse of thought in that there was a patient, Roberto, who was struggling and looking for help and felt he had to run and leave and get out of there and needed more air. He was suffocating. They were trying to help him, but it turned out that it was because, quote, as he is still very weak and lacks the mental strength to break away from his earthly ties, the poor creature has not been able to resist their influence. So the mental and emotional influence of his relations still on earth were still affecting him in his astral body in the chamber while there, and while they were trying to help him and realizing and trying to teach him that he needed to gain strength to break away from their influence, which they talk about on page 120. Let's see. Right, he had already rushed out and crying loudly that he needed to run home because of the influence of those mental thoughts and emotions. But they restrained him. They had to restrain him, take away some of his energy while they were applying, well, not only prostrating magnetic passes, but also healing magnetic passes at the same time. They agreed that they did well. And then interestingly, they realized they thought as a distraction to the incarnate individuals that were still sending these thoughts and generating this emotion and grieving, I guess, deeply grieving. The family itself needed an adjustment of attitude. And Tobias said, quote, they must be given a greater share of worries so that they may leave Roberto in peace. So there you go. Even though they're grieving, they needed a distraction, something to move on to, something to change their mental attitude, to leave Roberto alone now, instead of thinking that he's just gone and dead and they're never going to see him again, and trying to draw him back. You know, how can you be gone? How could you leave us? We need you, Dad, Father, where are you? We love you, we miss you. And then Roberto's trying to leave the chamber and run back home. Because he's being called and he doesn't have the strength to resist, they're going to give the family a greater share of worries to
Well,
distract them to move on with their lives. Now, that was very interesting.
that means they're going to experience a death or a trauma or an injury or an accident or a problem.
Right, exactly.
That
That's a
means
distraction. They carry on with their own lives and let Roberto go. Let him go and just go on with your life. And you said, right, an accident, an injury, or an emotional, mental, or physical problem, maybe, you know, some sort of worry or distraction in their regular life that they have to deal with to leave him alone, you know?
And
Yeah.
one can say, wow, positive beings are going to catalyze a trauma for his family to distract them from him.
Yeah.
Well, what's karmically allowable? Well, these are souls that are astrally binding a loved one. They call him a loved one, they love him, and they are astrally binding him. That doesn't look like positive action to me. Maybe, therefore, giving them some trouble not only distracts them and lets him go astrally, but also is a form of karmic return for the wrong action of their astral binding that they're unconscious of. Doesn't matter. And so it's very subtle, right? Okay, we'll just, set it up so that the brother-in-law has a car accident. Along with his higher self, but maybe somebody
Sure.
deserves that, or maybe, or obviously, it would be karmically allowable, non-infringing. So there are all
Right.
sorts of strange setups that get arranged.
Oh, sure. Or maybe an illness. Maybe one of Ribeiro's grandchildren by his son or daughter gets very ill,
Right,
you know,
and
and then they, so then everyone's distracted with that. Oh my God, you know, we don't want the grandbaby to die, right?
right.
So then they get distracted. They're not keeping Ribeiro down.
Right.
Their attention drawn, right? You see, so yeah. And I think that that is karmically allowable to, they can't come out and say that because of the audience that they're writing this for. But I think that it can be interpreted in that way for a more advanced audience, which you know we're discussing this with now. We would understand that. Well, okay, I see what they're doing. And they aren't really hurting anybody. I mean, even if say the child gets ill or the guy gets into an accident that they have to pay attention to. They didn't kill him. They didn't really severely maim him necessarily, but they just distracted him or them or those individuals long enough to let Ribeiro heal and move on with and get stronger so that he can deal with it himself, you know,
Yeah,
emotionally.
right. Well, astral cording, cording, is often pertains to negatively oriented spirits on the astral plane or thought forms that are astral that are attracted to a person's distorted thinking and behavior. But there's also cording between people who are overly emotionally attached to each other. And overly emotionally attached equals controlling. It ain't love. Ross said, for the fully balanced entity, there's no situation giving emotional charge. There's no emotional chargedness, but there's also no emotion other than love. And emotionalism is a form of control. And people don't seem to get that often. Some people overvalue emotionalism. Oh, very feelingful. But actually, emotionalism, as it arises interpersonally, is generally a form of control. And so astral cording can happen human to human during the incarnation and between planes, the physical and the astral. And there are countless dangers of emotionalism. And clearly, Brazil is a kind of hot-tempered, hot-blooded place. And
Oh,
but there's emotionalism all over the place, and that's second chakra drop-down that Ra talked about into Orange Ray, where lots of people are self-centered and overvalue their own emotional process and then impose it upon others, even in the guise of so-called love and care. I'm only doing this for your own good. It's only because I love you so much. And I was once told in a relationship by some girl that if a couple doesn't fight, it means they don't love each other. So people have been taught strong emotion is a sign of what? Love and care. Sometimes that's been taught. So and that then pertains also to over excessive attachment to physical body. And the cure being work. And we can talk about that later and next time. And this whole point about karma yoga, this the training given to these souls is basically karma yoga. So anyway, and I'll talk about that more after your presentation.
Another example too that I was going to move with is as far as going with controlling thought, which they used a perfect example of was self-controlling thought, and how damaging it can be if an individual isn't careful and if they're ignorant of their spiritual selves or the need for their spiritual education. Right there on page 21, it starts in the same chapter. He came across the prostate businessmen who were, even though he's reminded that they have already left the lower zones and now are in a period of quote unquote recovery, if you can call it that. These were the heedlessly, these individuals, the businessmen I'm talking about, heedlessly neglected their spirit selves. That's a quote. In these chambered patients are not only cared for, they are also prepared for their future redemption. Right. But then they say their suffering is of their own doing. Man's life is always centered wherever his heart is. And the interesting example or quote is, they were smugglers of eternal life. They expected mere earthly acquisitions to have the same value in the spirit spheres. They believed in criminal pleasures, the power of money, infringement of the law, and the imposition of self would cross the frontiers of the sepulcher and still be in force over on that side, on the spiritual side, offering them new opportunities for further follies. They were thoughtless businessmen who forgot to exchange their material acquisitions for spiritual currency. And these individuals were just preparing themselves for a long sleep. So their heart was in their physical acquisitions, the physical world, those activities, and real, and thinking, okay, when it's done, it's done. I'm just going to have a long sleep. And so he walks in, and these individuals are laying there with sinister countenances. They were laying quite still on low beds, unnoticeable, almost unnoticeable breath was the only sign of life they presented. And they are in a sleep much heavier than most of their ignorant brothers. They call them, Tobias and Narcissus said that they call them the negative believers. For instead of accepting the Lord, they were unconditional slaves of self. Instead of believing in life, action, work, they admitted only the victory of crime, immobility, and eternal nothingness. And so there they were sleeping, and then as they went, they were trying to apply strengthening passes to the patients. The individuals, after the treatment, began vomiting a black substance, a dark and viscous matter with cadaverous emanations. And then Tobias said, Narcissus said, they both said, they are expelling poisonous fluids, explained Narcissa. And Narcissa was doing her best to keep up with the cleaning, and that was when Andre picked up cleaning implements to help her clean up the mess. But there you go. I mean, so there, and there's an example of thought transforming an individual into a deep sleeper, a deep negative sleeper, because that's what they believed was going to happen. And so thought, thinking that, created that exactly for them in their life, or lack of life. There it was. And of course, they don't go on to explain if and when any of those individuals will come out of that long slumber, because they are trying to apply the healing passes, I assume, to wake them up. But they're not really, so far, don't look like they're having much luck.
Yeah, it's akin to an astral coma.
Yeah, and, exactly.
And,
I would say so. Yes.
You know, you get what you get what you expect after death to some degree. On page 7, one of the editors, Carlos Bernardo, an editor at GEAE, the organization that released the book in English, he wrote, wherever the human spirit goes after death, be it a spiritual colony of an English-speaking country or a spiritual town in ancient India, and that's true, people will go, people who are at this level of development in third density go to a culturally resonant astral settlement, whether it's simple or high-tech, going where is familiar, and he goes on, it always meets itself, meaning the human spirit or a human being always meets itself, carrying its conquests or past mistakes, beloved affections or inner enemies. In one word, we go to a place with which it has strong affinities. And if the person is a hardened skeptic, what I call a convicted atheist, then they go to sleep until their mind and vitality is strengthened enough to wake up on the astral and realize they haven't died, or they physically died, but they're still living. And so you get what you expect to some degree. And those that expect eternal sleep or nothingness have to be roused from astral coma later on. And that's very, very interesting. So, some more you'd like to say?
Sure. Yes, like that's an excellent idea, an example of, let's see, I was looking for the link here. Right, when, right, when he meets his, Silvera in chapter 35. He meets Silvera, who was the individual that his father they ran came into some financial dire straits, and his father just basically turned the family away, and he ended up in financial ruin. They moved away, never saw him again. And actually, at the time, Andre agreed with his father that it was the right thing to do, and chastises his mother for citing family to be more lenient. But then he meets them. Let's see, and that's on page 155. And he comes across him. He's one of the so Silveria is one of the Samaritans that is out, and after the Samaritans come back, he's just Silvera comes up and just says, "Hi, Andre. I didn't expect to see you here." And Andre's shocked. And then Narcissa encourages him to go and talk to Silvera and discuss the whole situation, and ask for forgiveness and work it out openly, because it's like what you talked about. You bring everything with you. I mean, anybody that people. It's been said before and it's been taught before, but it's actually really true. People have to realize whatever you've done and whoever you've done it to, positive or negative, you bring it with you, and you will come across those same individuals that you had those situations with on the other side. Good relationships, bad relationships, whatever it is. And either way, either on this side or on that side, we end up having to make amends for it. Because that's all karma. I mean, karma just doesn't stop when we pass from this life to the other side. It's ongoing, continually. The only other thing, too, that I thought was also really interesting was on, see, I can find this page 51, too. Another example of the thought processes of, believing that you're doing right, but then realizing that you're not, or partially realizing. And in that particular chapter, chapter 34, that is when there was the newcomers from the lower zone, and Andre comes across the plantation owner who had been in the lower zone. She had died in 1881, and we figured that she had spent 51 years in the lower zone and was finally rescued. And it was because she was relaying her story, and the reader figures out, well, it's because you had slaves and you tortured slaves and you killed some slaves on the whipping post, and you separated mothers from their babies and split up families. But you had been taught through your priest and the church that Negro individuals were not actually human, that they were just put on earth to serve the white man and to be slaves, and that as long as the priest came around, or either you went to him or he was coming to the plantation, and gave you absolution, that it was okay, and you could keep doing what you were doing, because every time you confessed and discussed and you said your prayers and you got absolved by the priest, everything was going to be okay. And then she died, and then she was tormented on a daily basis by those same spirits, spirit slaves on the other side, and still didn't quite get it. She had just come over, and Andre's trying to reason with her, and then Narcissa finally has to come up and say, Andre, we're here to kind of get these people into the chamber of rectification. You realize that they've just been liberated, and they're in a healing process, and reasoning with them now is not really going to make much of a difference, because she was still in the belief that she had been saved from heaven, and that for some reason, whatever, she'd been in purgatory and had been tormented for all those years, but now she'd been liberated, and that she was still in the right. in a lot of ways. So she had a lot of education to go through too. So there's another example of wrong thinking, wrong spiritual education and training, but believing it faithfully, thinking you're doing the right thing, thinking you're with the program, and finding out after the fact that you're not. And I've often wondered what happened to that priest or any of the priests that taught that, right?
He's
I mean, where are they at and what are they going through? Oh my God.
still down there.
Yeah, he's down there. I'm sure he's down there.
Yeah.
And probably was still down there after she left.
Probably. Yeah. I mean, encouraging others to harm is even a greater karmic liability than doing specific harm. Encouraging others to good is even more meritorious or karmically beneficial than simply an instance of doing good. And so Buddhism is got all this nailed down 2,500 years ago. This ain't new in the Buddhist world. It was Gautama praised those that encouraged others to do good and criticized or considered it as wrong speech. Those that encourage others to do harm or encourage others to kill or lie or steal on one's behalf is considered a wrong action, clearly. And so what you're showing there is that, ignorance of the law is no defense, as the human law says too, because wherein lies essential responsibility? It's not the responsibility of the priest that she did harm. It's hers. It's the responsibility of the priest that he taught wrongly and encouraged harm. But it's not her, it's not his doing that she did, because there'll be other people who listen to the priest and think, "Wow, you're telling me that it's that these Africans are subhuman and it's right for me to kill them at whim. I don't think that's right, and I will leave, or I won't do that." So there would be others in the congregation listening to the same sermon or the same philosophy who rejected it, but she didn't. She accepted it, and therefore took upon herself, or thereby took responsibility for her harming, because others would not have and would have rejected that message. And so that's another matter, because much of what's going on here is learning responsibility. There's some meta-analysis we can do, which is pretty much what we're doing a lot of here, of why is it that they're being taught work as the means of their own further evolution. It's a reframing of the common motivations for work, as well as a inculcation or teaching or of responsibility by doing rather than word. Meaning, they're being taught the value, the importance of one's speech, thought, word, and deed. And you're responsible for all your thought, word, and deed. And you will experience the consequences of your thought, word, and deed on earth as in heaven. And it's only by selfless work, or work as service, or love, wisdom based, cooperative, supportive, helpful, non-harming work, not self-aggrandizing work, or money-amassing work, or work for physical survival, which is the way people look at work down on here, down here on the world, in on the ground in this world. But it's a spiritualized understanding of work, integrated with a deep realization of, really, 360-degree responsibility for all of one's thoughts and words and deeds, that is being taught to these souls at this level of the astral. And so they're getting a new notion of work. Work is not about merely physical survival, nor financial amassing money, nor social prestige and getting to a higher level, nor is it any in rightly any form of selfish intent, as any kind of selfish intent will be harmful to you. While selfless intent or work as service, work as path, karma yoga, is going to benefit you the most, as well as benefiting others. And that's a major reorientation of thinking about work, and a major demonstration of the importance of the reality of unconditional responsibility for thought, word, and deed in this world and in the next, which is, the law of karma and causality, to people who hadn't, who really generally hadn't a clue of what's going on, which is the common lot of most folks down here on the ground with us here. Most folks down here on the ground, they have no idea why they're living. They have no idea why they're living. And the religionists take on what they're taught from the preacher and the pastor and the imam and the guru and whoever, and generally don't think too much. I was just talking to a lady last night, a client, about Christian dogma, doctrine, and how many people know all of what they're signed on to when they call themselves a Christian or of any religion? Very few. Meaning, the reality is that a lot of people in the congregations, or a lot of people, even the religionists, who have some view of afterlife and some sense of karma or responsibility, metaphysical responsibility for the way they live their life, won't agree with all the doctrines of their religion, but they don't even know it because they're not encouraged to think about them. And they're encouraged, with the view, you're a member of this religion because you come every Sunday. And that's it. And what you say with your mouth is sufficient, rather than what you have, learned in your heart, or what you really think about all of this, which you really haven't thought about, because they are not encouraged to think about all the different doctrines and what's your view of this and that and the other one in most religions. And even in Buddhism, Buddhism in Thailand is very, very Catholic. It's very organizational, and a lot of people just go and do make some merit, but they don't really want to listen deeply to the teachings. And that's the general level of mind of humanity, of 3D repeaters native here, is that they don't really want to use their mind too much. It's very limited how much they want to. And that's why karma yoga is taught here, not jnana yoga, not the yoga of study and development of view and understanding, but learning by doing and taking on a new way in which work becomes service, and work is spiritualized. The spiritualization of work is critical. And if if you take a step back, and I'll go, I'm not going to take your whole time here, Brent, but if you take a step back and look at Earth humanity throughout the ages, 75,000 years according to Ra, monasticism is not so big, and so Raja Yoga, meditative yoga path, is not really going to take with these folks. Likewise, Jnana Yoga or study, most people are really happy to drop learning after college or after a degree or after a vocational certificate that gets a job. Most people are not really interested in learning. I mean, it seems like that to me. And so Jnana Yoga's out, and Raja Yoga's out. Hatha Yoga, the asanas and the postures, well, forget it. Some people are interested, but hardly anyone. People would prefer sports like, football and baseball and soccer. Okay, well, that's cool, but that ain't Hatha Yoga. And then you've got what? Bhakti yoga, devotional, devotion to a guru or God or a deity. Well, that's okay, but that's really so ripe for distortion and manipulation, and so Buddha becomes a god, and Jesus becomes a god, and Jesus' mother Mary becomes a god, and then people get stuck in, thoughtless devotionalism with a concomitant self-devaluation. God is great, and I'm a little worm, and something like that. Most people believe that. The Buddha is great, and I'm a nothing. And so, or the guru is great, and I kiss his feet, which is, it's okay to kiss somebody's feet, I guess, but you are everything he is, or himself is a being of infinite worth. So this group has got a real problem, they can't really study well, so Jnana Yoga doesn't help. They're not interested in disciplined physical activity beyond sports, so Hatha Yoga's out. They're easily manipulated by fraudulent leadership, and therefore Guru Yoga or Bhakti Yoga doesn't do so well. And then what? Raja Yoga, they ain't gonna sit down for 30 minutes or 30 years and meditate, so Raja Yoga's out. So all you've got is Karma Yoga. And there's a link I'll just send, Wikipedia on Karma Yoga, which compares to other forms of yoga, similar to what I've been saying. And that's very interesting. This group of 3D repeaters can only be helped, perhaps actually only be helped by Karma Yoga. Because, I mean, look at our experience trying to share Jnana Yoga, trying to share study, the fruits of study, or reformed understanding, reformed view, and spiritual understanding, what we're doing. How many people want it? Nearly no one. Even the religionists don't want to hear about spiritism, really, actually. They don't even want to hear that heaven ain't so different than earth. Uh-oh. You mean I can't just eat bonbons all day and dance with the angels on the harps on the clouds, with the cl harps on the clouds? No, you really can't. Meanwhile, higher levels of the astral and higher dimensions are not bureaucratic, as I've said before. And there's no need for chambers of regeneration or rectification. Ministry of regeneration, chambers of rectification, not needed, because people are not more spiritually minded people, or those that are clearly polarized positive, and wanderers who didn't screw themselves up too much, don't need so much healing, and don't need elementary spiritual view. We still need, perfection of morality or improvement of love, wisdom in thought, word, and deed. Yeah. But some of what this astral city is about is moving out of a thoughtless, self-centered life to a thoughtful, spiritualized sense of purpose and meaning in life. And that's why they're giving them a Christian-centered view. Not only is it because it's Brazil, or mainly because of that, but that's why even countries have the Christian view, which, and this is a pretty fine Christian view, which may not appeal to wanderers so much, or us in some ways, but they still they can't, they can't go from thoughtless materialism to thoughtful spiritual purposefulness in one leap. They've got to go from, thoughtless materialism, self-centeredness, to God the King and Jesus his Son, and the path of love thy neighbor as thyself, love one another as you love God. In a very hierarchical, cosmological, religious perspective. It's hierarchical, it's quite rigid. God the Father, and you're the child, or you're whatever, you're the sinner who's trying to become unsinned, unsinning, by the mediation of Jesus the Son. Okay, well, it doesn't really have to be that. That's not the only teaching that is helpful, but it may be the most helpful for many of the people here. And something like that. So we underestimate the spiritual immaturity of Earth humanity, no doubt. And we may underestimate what they know that we don't know, too. Meaning they do 3D better than us in many cases, yes. And they may be okay with things that we can't handle. So we can learn here too from a lot of people who may not really have a spiritual view, but it really is the case. And I think Astral City shows us clearly that the vast majority of the folks around us are 3D repeaters and have a lot to do in terms of reforming view and spiritualizing daily life and clarification of purpose and intention to get themselves out of this cycling under the thumb of Orion proxies. So, Brent?
Yes, exactly. I agree completely. That's a good point. That was pretty much the point. And I think you're right. It's so difficult because many, many, many individuals don't want to do any work. They don't think there's any work to be done. But I think that they're taught that from the beginning. And that's why they're 3D repeaters. They come out and say, well, you don't do anything. You show up, you listen to a lecture, you pray, you get absolution, you go through a ritual. And you don't have to worry about it because the priests take care of it. That's their job. You're not responsible for anything. You don't have to take any responsibility for anything, which is ridiculous. And then, of course, as you mentioned a lot earlier, even on that plane, astral plane and higher, all the astral planes and higher, ignorance of the law is no excuse. But then again, even I think the safety valve there is if an individual is willing to adhere to the basics, treat others as you would treat yourself, just show respect, love over anything else, treat people with love, and kindness. And if you can't do that, then don't do them any harm. Just walk away from it. And then if people just followed those basic rules, they would kind of be okay for the most part. But even then, there's the people get themselves into tricky situations where they just can't resist. And but the power of thought and the power of how it affects us every single day in our daily lives, and how our thoughts affect us and how our thoughts affect other people. Is a very good one of the most important lessons in the book. It's not the only lesson, of course, but it was the one that I was thinking I wanted to today and list some of the examples that they found in the chambers of individuals that really messed it up. They did it to themselves as exampled by the businessmen who just went for the long sleep and are suffering in the astral coma, as you put it, which was a very good way to put it, or the individuals that just had controlling individuals around them or were controlling themselves also and were feeling the results of it. Maybe it was karma. Maybe that Robero who kept trying to run away and go back to his family was probably controlling himself and felt that he had to get back to his family instead of dealing with his what was going on right there and heal himself. Excellent examples all across the board. And also keeping in mind too, as they found in the book, in other parts, there was that section about the vampire, where there are individuals out there that are not looking for spiritual healing. They are not looking to advance. They enjoy negativity. They enjoy being evil, and they want to stay that way. And anything that has to do with positive spiritual improvement and growth, and love, they don't want to have anything to do with it, and they want to destroy it. And that's exactly, and that's where they're at. And they get left alone, of course, but they also, the Astral City, of course, had their defenses, their magnetic devices that defended against attack from the evil entities on all levels. So that's also something to bear in mind. There is evil out there, and you got to protect yourself and guard against it. Otherwise, you'll get to individuals especially 3D repeaters, will end up being taken advantage of and just used for their energy and their thought processes and their anger and their negativity through the thoughts that they generate, so that other entities can feed off of it. So those are all interesting points, but that was pretty much, well, we're almost, I think we're done with about the hour, so I should probably wrap it up now, but we can continue on next week with some more valid points and interesting points of the book. What do you think?
Yeah, definitely. Let me do a wrap up, okay?
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
So yeah, I think next week I'd like to talk more about karma yoga. Here's a second link from the Vedanta Society of Southern California. In Southern California is was a kind of sacred space, actually. Ojai, Somerville, a lot of theosophists and Vedantists settled there. Self-Realization Fellowship, Yogananda's group. Southern California has a certain energetic that, you know, very fourth chakra, actually, and can go positive or negative, or highly distorted, like Hollywood and L.A., or somewhat purified. And so the Vedanta Society of Southern California has that page talking about karma yoga. And we'll talk about karma yoga as the practice of no solar. And then we can also talk about defenses of the astral city and their proximity to evil, so-called evil. Proximity metaphysically and also in consciousness, as the people are moving out of, you know, a goodly number of the people there came out of hell. And souls that don't have to go to hell may also go to the Nosolar, this level of the astral. But there are other levels beyond this, like where Dr. Louise's mother was. So next week we can talk about the stratification of the astral plane. We can talk about karma yoga in further depth. Any other topics you want to bring up, we can ponder. And again, we'll probably take one or two more weeks and see, because there's really a lot to say here, and I think our unpacking of main principles is very helpful. So thank you, Brent, for your commentary, and nice to dialogue with you about it. And thank you, everyone, for listening. I hope it's been helpful. Next time we'll take it deeper. Take good care of yourselves, and good night.